morning, good morning, good morning. How many excited to be in the Father's house? How many here to celebrate the Father for what he's done? I mean, that we are fathers here on earth, but there's a Father in heaven who's done so much for us. And then today I get to speak about the Father's love and generation to generation. If it's your first or second time here, we want to say welcome home, welcome home, welcome home. My name is George Caban. I am a senior pastor of the most beautiful church in the world. If you're here, you're part of that. And I'm excited that I get to share a word with you guys today on Father's Day. And we're on generation to generation is what we are speaking this month. And how many believe in generational blessings? Yes. And I think that the minute I came into the walks of God, I started understanding that God is a God of covenants. And so we get to celebrate it and celebrate him today. And I just want to speak a little bit about what it looks like to pass a generational blessing from one to another, and how God uses men. Even in the beginning of the scriptures, when we talk about Abraham did not have a Bible. He was the walking Bible. And I think that nowadays people are looking for walking Bibles. Amen. If we're going to lead a generation, we got to lead them by action, not by words, because they're looking for someone they can imitate, right? And talking about imitation, I was hanging out with my daughter yesterday. She was like, Dad, I'm going to take you shopping. I was like, yes. I'm ready. She says, I'm going to pick you up. I was like, what? Man, this is awesome. So she said, what mall you want to go to? I want to go to Willowbrook. And so we went to Willowbrook and we're shopping. She's like, what you like? I like this. And so I'm grabbing clothes and I'm like, I like this. And then she's grabbing clothes. She's like, oh, I like this. I was like, okay, that's great. So we stand in line and we're ready to pay. And guess who had to pay? I mean, she did say she was going to take me there. She didn't say she was going to pay, but I'm thinking it's Father's Day. So I'm like, yeah, take that one, because I'm thinking she's paying. So I'm like just grabbing, and then she goes, all right, pay the lady. Generation to generation, right? But I got to hang out with her, and just to see her growing, right? She's 20 years old now, and just the other day, it was little, you know, you see them so little, and then they start growing, and you be like, man, how'd you grow so fast? It took soon my 4 years to drive in her car, because she still saw her as a five-year-old. I mean, she's 20. She could drive. And I get to see that. And in my life, I think for most of us that are fathers, you really don't know love till you have a child, right? And the father's love is so profound when you have a child that it changes your whole life around. And I just want to show a little bit of when my kids growing up, and have a couple pictures I want to share with you. This this is my daughter when she was little. She still does the same thing, but now she's bigger. When she wants something, she just strolls down the stairs. And then this is Sergio. I get cute. Yeah, and these are the things that transform a father, right? Because it is more than just giving your kids what they need on a natural level, but there's a spiritual level that kids are yearning for the fathers to provide, right? And that is the teaching of who God is. We have to put our kids on our knees and just talk to them about who God is, because they're looking at us as the resemblance of who God is, right? They're looking for this pouring. And as I keep seeing my son grow, and the next picture, they're a little older, they're Serge bigger, and my little girl. And then that's Ellie. She looks totally different now. But I got another addition. See, so that's my grandson, right? And I get to see another generation, and I have the opportunity to pour into him who God is. Because in this world, they'll teach him how to do business, and that's great. But I think the biggest thing a father or grandfather could do is pass on the knowledge of the God that they serve. Because you got to understand, it is your God. It's not their God till they take him as their God. When I preach, I say, Ellie, I'm going to talk to you about my God. Because he is not her God until she makes him her God. Because you can't live off my experiences or my journey. You got to make your own. And God is willing to take that journey with someone, right? He's just looking for someone who says, boom, you're it, right? Or you're the man, right? That's when God picks them up. And here's little Logan. And this is the whole family. This is the little clan. This is the Caban clan, right? But the Caban clan started with one man who said yes to God. It started with one man who was in famine and found that it was nothing that can fulfill him but other than to have a relationship with God. Because you could have everything in this world, yet inside there's a famine, there's something happening, and the only one that could fill that famine is God. And you got to get to that place, and God uses people when they're in famines. You know why? Because in a famine, you have no resources. And when you run out of resources, then you turn your heart to God. God will always use a time of despair in your life to show you who he is. And sometimes they're like, oh, but God allowed this. So this. No, no, no. In this world, you will have trouble. This is what Jesus says. So whether you serve God or you don't serve God, there's going to be trouble. Except when you serve God, you're standing on top of the rock instead of the sand. Come on, somebody. And if that's what we're standing on, if that's what my dependency is on, the stone, that is my job as a father to pass it on to the next generation. It is my job to take the baton and pass it to the next generation, because if the baton falls, it's probably going to be 2 or 3 generations before they see God again. That's what happened with the Israelites. The Israelites will stand for God, and then all of a sudden there was one generation that went, nah, we don't really need. And then all of a sudden they went into slavery, and they start yelling out to God, God, where are you? God, where are you? And God is always so much precise on his covenant, because He is a father of love, he is a father of covenant, and he is a father of legacy. I want to talk about legacy today, because legacy is what you leave behind, not so much on the earthly. I want you to understand this, because it's okay to pass on properties and pass on all this wealth. It's great, but unless God is the center of that wealth, the wealth means nothing, because if your wealth is not purposed for its purpose, it'll just destroy you. When you think that money is for me, no, money is for you, yes, but there is a cause that you've been called to. You got 80 summers. I always say it every year. We got 80 summers to figure that out, to figure out what we're doing here, right? And that's a lot of people's question is that, is purpose, right? When you don't have purpose, you're hopeless. Why? Because there's no purpose. And the thing is that the centerpiece of purpose, watch this, the centerpiece of purpose is God. Because when God created man, he created man for relationship. Right? There was no Bible when he created Adam. It was just Adam and God, and they were walking and talking. And so my opening scripture is going to be in Genesis 1, 27, 28. And we're going to read this because I want you to grab this morning. I think there's a responsibility as the head of the house, as a man of the house, to not only be a provider in the things that are natural, but there also has to be a provider for the things in the spiritual. There's a responsibility that's upon the man. My subtitle today is called You're the Man. Because I say this, when I go to heaven, I don't want Jesus to say, oh, good, well done, faithful servant. I want him to say this, You're the Man. Because by the time we get there, either you accomplished what God called you to do or didn't. And I want to finish what he called me to do. And despite what I see, I'm going to finish it because I want to hear those words from him. I send it as a request. When you see me, could you say, I'm the man? So let's read. Suma's like, amen, that's my man. My man. So God created man in his own image and the likeness of God. He created him. Watch this. Male and female. Hello. He created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it. Using, what's this? Using all its vast resources in the service of who? And then what? That hasn't changed. That hasn't changed. And have dominion, right? So that's power and authority over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and every living creature that moves upon the earth. This is the main thing that God has called us to do. It's not to be only a service to man, but be a service to God. And when we talk about service to God, is the ability to have a relationship with God. And I want to say today, if you never heard the voice of God or have the leading of God, I'm going to pray that God opens your ears of your heart. Because there's no way we're going to accomplish what God has called us to do without hearing from God. Before there was any Bible, there was the voice of God. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. If I went to Israel about maybe 20 years ago, no, was it 20 years ago? About 10 years ago. And I would ask them, the Jews, I would ask them, who's your father? They'll go, Abraham. I'm like, Abraham, but Abraham was, right? So Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is the forefathers of the faith of who they believe they are and their relationship with God. And they go all the way back to them, right? So they don't say their natural father. They say their father of the covenant with God, because God is a God of covenant. And so when we talk about covenants, it's talking about a relationship. When we talk about covenants, it's something that is unbreakable. When we're talking about covenant, we're talking about something that lasts from one generation to another. Every time that Israel messed up and went sideways, God will get them and go, because of your father, Abraham. Because you got to understand, when someone stands up for God, God goes into covenant with you. And even if your next generation goes sideways, he'll go get them and say, you knucklehead, if it wasn't for your father... Why? Because God is a God of covenant. When I see my last scene here, I know that I'm leaving in covenant with God, that I'm leaving knowing that God has my back on my generations to come. That one day, maybe Sergio's son, could look back and be like, there was my crazy grandfather, George, and he started, because it always takes one, right? Tell your neighbor you're the man. It takes one man to be in covenant with God. It took one man, Abraham. Listen to what I'm about to tell you. Abraham heard God in the middle of a place that it was just idols everywhere. The father had idols. Everybody had idols. Now think of the situation that Abraham was put in. Because, first of all, I wanted to think, like, what's going on in his life, right? Because the Bible doesn't speak about all the inside, so we got to put some insight into it. Why was he so frustrated that he was seeking God? Because you cannot find God unless you seek him, and you seek him because you're in a place of famine. When you're in a place of famine, that means you're in a place that you have no answers. When you're in a famine, is a place where you become the less God. You become a no God, because as a God, many times when we depend on ourselves, we think we have all the answers to we don't have it. And when we don't have the answers to the things that are happening, is that when we turn to God, because it's like, I can't figure this out. It's a famine down here. There is no rain. There's nothing. There's no resource. And we turn our hearts to God. And that's when God looks for us and sees us, because he looks for those with a constrict heart. And so Abraham, I don't know what he was going through. Now, the scriptures do say that he was rich. He had money. He had slaves and servants, and he had all this. Yet he wasn't content with what he was had, because if he would have been content, he wouldn't heard from God. He heard from God because he was in an empty place, even though he had resources. So not necessarily is resources lacking in our life that turn to God. It's inside. I was in a place of dryness. I was in a place with idols. I was empty, right? And then I turned my heart to God, and I heard from God. And so Abraham heard from God. He says, go. And he didn't tell him no direction, just go. Now, think of the situation that he's in. He's in a situation that everybody's looking at him like, who talked to you? God spoke to you? What God, right? Because there's a place that there is no God. And I love the fact that when you ever turn to God, everybody's going to look at you like you're weird. Because it is not normal to serve God. It's not normal to follow a voice. It's not normal to go and be led by someone you don't see. Because if we don't see it, we don't believe it. But God is looking for people, for men, right, to stand up and stand up for a generation. Why? When I stood up, my generation before, none of them, I don't know, maybe 5 generations ago, maybe they served God. But I don't know who it was, but I know God looked at me, saw me, picked me up, and I started a new thing. And when you're going to start a new thing, you got to understand that you're setting a new standard, and all hell's going to break loose in your life. People say, oh, when you serve God, everything is great, lilies. And no, it's not. It's not all lilies and flowers. Because you're going against the culture. You're like a salmon going against the water, right? You're doing something different, because you got to understand, you're doing something different, but you're changing. Watch this. You're changing a generation. You think it's just you, but it's not you. It's your kids' kids. It's your kids' kids' kids. It's all it takes is one man. And always, I found this, the first one to do something is the hardest. If you're the Abraham of your life, if you're the Abraham of your family, what is that Abraham of your family? Is the first one that says yes to God. And I'm not talking about saying yes to God in the heart and having them in your heart. I'm talking about serving God. Because Joshua said, as far as me and my house was concerned, we will serve God. So serving God is being part of what God is doing. This is the Father's house. And when we're part of the Father's house, I remember I went 21 days fasting, and you didn't have to do 21 days fasting to hear this. And God spoke to me and said, listen, you take care of my house, I'll take care of yours. He didn't stutter. That was all he said, right? And from that moment on, I just knew that I will serve God. Why? I'm going to make the trail for my next generation to come. I'm making the trail. I'm carving the trail to be of greatness, right? When you have greatness inside of you, you can't settle for mediocrity. What God has placed inside of you is greatness, and probably some of you are feeling that. Like there's so much more to life than this. And you're stuck within the perimeter of this world. And God is saying, hey, I want you to go and move out of faith. Move in faith out of the box that you're in. Because God is going to do something. And even if he doesn't do it with me and I don't see the greatness, or maybe Serge or Logan, but it's going to be a generation. It's going to be one that's going to be lifted up that God's going to use in the most powerful way. How I know that? Because I know that I know that I know. So let's go to Abraham. Genesis 12:1. Here's the instructions he gives. But it says, and the Lord has said to Abraham, I want to stop there for a second, because this relationship that we have with God is a relationship and you get to hear from God. Where there is an impulse, where there is a voice internally, there is a guiding, right? We got the Holy Spirit that tells us of all things yet to come. To me, that was the greatest thing I found out when I started serving. I'm like, you got the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will tell you of all the things yet to come, because all of us want to know what's coming. What better way than to have the Holy Spirit, right? And so this relationship that we have now with the Holy Spirit was even greater than Abraham, because he's always with us. With Abraham, it will come for a moment. But with us, come on, somebody, we have him every day. The Holy Spirit is with us. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. We have the ability to commune with God. We just got to set the time apart. And if you are a man of the house and you're saying, as far as me and my household is concerned, we will serve God, then there has to be a moment of dedication to God. Nobody ever built a relationship with anyone just visiting once or twice. It's an everlasting relationship. It's a dependency on God that allows you to have your own stories. Do you know that you're writing your own story? You're your own Bible. You're the Bible that you're going to read to your kids and your next generation. And the only stories you're going to have with God is the ones you provoke God or move out in faith by God or by God's voice. You will never write nothing, oh, this happened or that. No, no. God told me. I don't know if you have those stories that God said. I got a lot of stories. I can stay here for days. God said. Why? Because God has the ability to commune with man as long as man says yes to God. It ain't going to happen, you know, in the midst of binging on Netflix. It's going to happen in the midst of you going separating and listening and hearing from God. And not only when things are going bad, but we commune with God. Like, communing with God is not based on what he can give me. It's based on what my rendering over to God in relationship. Look at Genesis 12. He says, the Lord said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to a land that I will show you. He didn't tell him where he was going to show him whenever he started walking. I will make you into, look at the promise. I will make you into a great nation. Look at what he says. He said, I want you to leave your perimeter of what you know, and I'm going to make you great. I'm not going to make you great where you're at, because you're trying to make it yourself. This is when you come outside of the perimeter of what I'm calling you, when I'm pulling you out of this culture to do something, I will make you great. Woo. It says, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name what? Great. I will. Look what he's saying. God will, not you will. You ain't going to give your name. You're not going to make yourself great, which you can. But in the eyes of God, he says, I'm going to do it. Because when God does it, everybody knows it was God, because there was no capability of you doing it. That's how God works. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. You don't have to curse nobody. Hello? Your enemies are not your enemies. They're God's enemies. Anybody that comes against you, they're coming against him. Because there's a covenant. When you, man, there's so many things that come along when you say yes to God. And when I mean yes to God, it's to devote your life to God. Say, God, here is my life. I surrender it. I sacrifice my life over to you. As I lay down, right? I lay down my life. Why? Because God could do something with someone who's dead, but he can do something with someone who's alive. Have you ever seen somebody in a funeral telling somebody where they want to go? You'll never say, hey, make a left there. Okay. No. Someone who's dead could be led. Only dead people could be led. In other words, dead to what you think is great. And God says, I want you to give me what's in your hand. How many seen that the thing, let's make a deal? Yeah. And let's make a deal, they give you $500. Then they'll go and say, hey, give me what's in your hand right now for window number three. And you don't even know what's in there. Sometimes there's something great, right? People are like, oh, but they're looking at the 500, but I could do my hairs, my toes, I go to Kmart and get like 10 bags. No? Wow, that's how backed up I am. What is Walmart. Walmart, 8 Kmart. And this is what God says, right? And it's the same thing with God. When I came to the walks of God, watch this. He says, give me what you have. And I thought it was great. I had 3 car dealerships. He says, give me what's in your hand, and I'll give you what's in window number 3. Because, see, when God calls you to do something, he'll never show you what it is until you start walking on his faith. You'll never know what's in window number 3 until you give up what's in your hands. Sometimes we say, oh, yeah, I'm good, I'm great. That's good, but God is greater. When you think, oh, man, I got it, I got this, I got that, and God says, give me this, and this is so good, because sometimes God will ask you to give up what you have because he wants to give you something great, and in the midst of you giving up what you have, you'll start doubting. Because when God says, I want you to give me all your 3 car dealerships, I want you to give me everything you have, and I was like, whoa, he says, give me what's in your hand, your 3 car dealers, and I'll give you what's in window number 3. And I was like, but I was in such a place of desperate that the 3 car dealerships didn't do nothing for me, so I might as well get window number 3 from God. Because sometimes we think because we have money that is fulfillment. Fulfillment is not money. Purpose is fulfillment. Woo! Finding why you was created for is the greatest thing that you'll ever do. Because once you do it, I was talking to my daughter, and I'm like, Ellie, could I share something with you? So she's driving, but keep your eyes on the road, right? So I say, you know that I could do a $1 million deal, a $5 million deal, a $4 million deal. I could do this and I could do that. And it's okay. I high five it. It's great. It's a good job. I said, but I can go and say, hold on. I'm preaching on Sunday. I'm separating myself Saturday to bring a message. And I get more fulfillment from that than I would from any multi-million dollar deal. Why? Because it is purpose. It is fulfillment. This is fulfillment for me. I'm serving, but in the serving is my fulfillment, right? Because this is the window number 3 for me. I don't know what the window number 3 for you is until you let go of what's in your hand. Come on, somebody. You got to let go of what you have, what you think is riches. It's not riches. Because God wants to do something what? Great. He wants to make your name great. Look what it says. I will. I will. How many I wills? It's his will, not your will. But if you want to do your will, he'll never do his will in you. It can't be 2 wills in one place. Come on. When Jesus was at Gethsemane, he said, let it be your will, not my will. Why? There was 2 wills. Oh, this is so good. What is your will and what's his will is 2 different worlds. And unless you commune with him, you'll never find out what his will is. Woo. You're the man. You're the man. And so this is not just only a generational blessing, but it's also a fulfillment for the years you have on earth. That when you are, is your last days of earth and you're about to breathe your last breath, you are like that milk carton that has no milk in it. You know that every milk carton has an expiration date? And unless you use it by the time it has, it'll go bad. I told God, I want to be that milk carton that doesn't have a drop in it. Like, they got to squeeze it and throw it out when my expiration day comes. Why? I want to pour everything that he's given me out here on earth. Because in heaven, everything is done. Here is a dependency on humanity and the man to come and stand up for something greater, to stand up for God. We don't see him, but we know he exists. We don't see him, but I know when I went and accepted Jesus into my life, there was chains broken in my life. I didn't see him, but I know that I sensed his love in my life. I didn't see him, but he told me he loved me. I didn't see him, but I believe. That's moving by faith. That's what God is looking. Look at Abraham. He moved by what? Faith. You know what he's called? The father of faith. He's the father of faith. Why? There was no Bible. There was no priest. It was just him in a desperate place of famine and calling out to God. God, if you're real, come and talk to me. If you're real, that's what I did. I said, God, if you're real, come and get me. He got me. Like, watch what you ask God for. If you ask for a sign to serve him, I said, you come and get me. And if you come and get me, I will serve you the rest of my life. I didn't know that was the best thing that I ever said. That was a vow. I said, you come get me. And he went and got me. You know, my story is crazy because I did witchcraft for so many years and I was so in that place and God came and started talking to me. I was like, man, I didn't know God talked because I grew up Catholic. So Catholic, you see the Jesus on the cross. I'm like, well, he's still on the cross. How could he talk to me? But not understanding in my innocence, God was doing something. Why? I was in a place of famine. I was in a place of idols. And I said, God, if you're real, come get me. And I heard his voice. And so he says, I will bless him. I bless you. I will. So we know that Abraham went into a place where he once started moving on faith, right? He starts moving. He starts bringing all his people along, and he's telling his people, God said. And they're all probably looking at him weird because at that time there was no church. It was no Bible. It was just, you know, this guy's listening to voices. But they didn't say nothing. They just went along with him. He left, and what happens is the minute he leaves, guess what happens? He runs into a famine. A famine. Now, in those times, I want you to understand that sheep and lambs and goats are the value. That was the monetary thing. The more you had, the more richer you are. But to go into a famine with all these animals, guess what's going to happen? His whole wealth is going to be dispersed. Like, it was going to go away. Now, he could have done something. He could have went back home. Like, think about it. Be like, nah, I think I heard the wrong voice. Let me just go back to where I know there's water. Let me go back to the regular place I'm used to. Let me go back to my old ways, because in my old ways, I know how to handle it. I can't handle the unknown. Come on, somebody. He could have said that, but you know what he did? He continued forward. He continued forward knowing, no, God will call me. And he ends up in a house where he says that his wife is his sister, so they won't kill him. And at the end of the day, God shows up into the man's dream, and he gives him 10 times how much he came in with. Why? Because you will... First, your test will come, and then comes what God has said in your life. And a lot of times we shrink back when something happens that doesn't look like what God said. And so because our eyes are doubting, then our hearts start doubting and we don't see it. But Abraham didn't do that. That's why he called the father of faith. He kept going forward. In the famine, his faith was tested and he was doubled. And so now he's having this relationship. He has a son named Isaac. Isaac was his son. Now, remember this picture. There was no Bible. All Abraham had to give his son was his stories with God. So Isaac is listening to him. Isaac is being brought up in who God is. Isaac, the baton is being passed on. And let's go to Genesis 26 a little further on. See, famines is our place where your faith is tested. And what I mean by famine is a place of need. It's a place of desperation. It's a place where you have no answers. I don't know if you've ever been there, but if you have no answers, that is considered a famine. And it's usually the place where we turn our hearts to God. Why? He is the only one that can get us out. And it's when God encounters us in a special way. Look what he says to Isaac. That's his son, right? So you got Abraham, Isaac. So we're going through the story here. Now, there was a famine in the land. Besides the previous famine in Abraham's time. So here it is, denoting the next generation is going through what Abraham went. But guess what? Isaac knew what happened with Abraham and saw how God glorified himself. Come on. So he was like, okay. And Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines, in Gerar. And the Lord appeared to Isaac and said, here he goes. I'm going to remind you because he's a God of covenants. He says, do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where I will tell you to live. Stay in this land for a while, and I will be with you, and I will bless you. For you and your descendants, I will give all these lands, and I will confirm the oath I swore to who? He said, because of your dad? Because of your dad standing up? I'm going to give you the same thing I gave him. I'm going to give it to you, and it's going to keep going down the pipe. And here, it was a drought. Now, we know we're not farmers here. I don't think anybody's a farmer here, but we know that in farming, you don't plant the seed when there is no rain, right? If it's a drought, if it's a desert, you don't plant none. But because God is so good and goes against our thinking, he told Isaac, I want you to plant now. And he planted and got 100-fold and never rained. Because God will take out of the miracle, right? What is a miracle? Is it the impossibility? Because you have believed God and you believe him in the impossible. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning. If you believe in the impossible, God will, you will see his glory. You will see his glory. And the glory is usually seen in a famine, in a place of need, in a place of, because what? If God took you out of one, he'll do it again. And usually in those times when God did something, they will put a stone. You know why they put a stone? I'm going to tell you why they put a stone. So that when the next generation asks and say, what's that stone about? They will say what God did. We have to have our stones in our lives. We have to have stones in our lives. Why? The stones represent what God did when you can't. The stones represent the power of God in your life, right? And that only happens when you stand up and you say, I'm going to serve God. And so Isaac was being driven. No Bible, no nothing. It was just plain relationship. It was like, let me talk to you about my God. Let me tell you what my God did. And Isaac had that inside of him, right? It was implanted in their hearts to trust God. And then he faces the same thing. He was like, hold on, my dad went through this. I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to just believe and I'm going to stay. And God blessed them. So Isaac had a son. Because remember, the relationship goes from one to another. And Jacob was the son of Isaac. And Jacob was a deceiver. The story says that, you know, he was a con. He wanted the father's blessing. He wanted the father's blessing so much that he conned his father into thinking that he was a firstborn when he wasn't. He was a second. So what happens? He goes and steals the blessing. He wanted the father's blessing because in those times they knew if I give you a staff, like in those times, if I give you my staff, that staff represents the blessing of God. So he wanted the blessing of God, but he didn't want God because he didn't know God, because if he knew God, he wouldn't deceive. He would just wait his turn. So the story goes on that he goes and, but mind you, he is being raised up by Isaac. So Jacob knows who God is. He knows the story. He just chose not to believe. He chose not to serve God. It wasn't his God. But here it is. He goes and he runs and runs into a famine. Why? He's running from his brother because his brother wants to kill him because he took the blessing. So he has to leave with nothing. He just left. And when he leaves, he goes into this mountain. And then in the midst of the mountain, in that famine, he has a dream. And in that dream, God speaks to him. And he goes in Genesis 28. The next verse. Yeah. So this is the vision, he says. He says, there above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father. Who? He passed Isaac. Because it's always the first one who stands up that God remembers. I will give you, Abraham and the God of Isaac, right? I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth. You will be spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All people on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you, and I will watch over you wherever you go. I will bring you back to this land, and I will not leave you until I have done what I promised you. Do you know that after this, he said to God, if you're my God, and whatever you give me, I'm going to give you 10%. So even at that, you would think you have that vision, and he goes, if you're my God. So it wasn't even his God. If we know the story, he really found God after that, right? Because Jacob becomes Israel from where the 12 tribes come from, right? So we see Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. Now, this is what I want you to see, that none of these were Bibles, none of these were churches, none of these were anything other than a relationship that one man decided to have with God and pass it on to another generation. It was about a Bible written by their own stories, and that's what God is looking for. God is looking for someone who will stand up in the middle of a gap of a generation that's moving sideways. If you look at what's going on in this world, everything is going sideways. Everything is getting from worse to worse. Why? Look, they say, oh, look at the shootings in the schools. Well, they took God out of the schools. What do you expect is going to happen? They took God out of the schools. The schools were created to teach about God and everything else. And then they still teach everything else except God. Because anytime you pull God from something, there's chaos. It is God who puts all things together and keeps all things together. He's the glue that puts all things together. And when you don't have God in the middle, like a lot of times I speak to people who are getting married, I'm like, God has to be the center. I've been married for 20 years. I've been with Suma for 28 years. And the center of it after it was chaos before God. But when God came, it became the center. It's what kept everything together. And so we got to understand that God has to be the center of it all. And so Jacob has 12 tribes and 12 kids. And these 12 kids, all he taught them all. But then he spoke to one. They only listen one, so Joseph. So here it is, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. These three, now they pass it on to the 12 tribes. There was no Bible. This is what I want you to understand today, that you're the man, right? You're the one that God has called to create your own story. You are responsible to create your own story to pass down, right? Abraham is gone. Isaac is gone. But there is a you today that could create. God, if God moved there, don't you think God will do it now? Even greater, we have the Holy Spirit. We can do greater things. Jesus says, you're going to do greater things. Like, we need to come outside of our comfort zone and trust God. Why? This is all we got. The way everything is going, unless we start establishing God in the household, then where's this world going to? I think it's time for everyone to stand up at this moment. And so Joseph, in Genesis 41, Joseph is sold by the brothers, hated by the brothers. They don't like him. He's the favorite of Jacob, right? Something is a problem when you're favored by the father. When you're favored by the father, everybody's going to hate you. So if they hate you, it's just a regular thing. That's what happens with anointing and grace, right? When you get the grace of God over your life, people are going to hate the grace that you carry. And so they went and they sold them to the slaves and they take them away. And then a famine is about to hit. But before the famine hits, Joseph goes to the top of Potiphar's life, a house. And everything, watch this, everything he touched turned into gold. Everything, they were like, man, God is with him because everything he touches is with gold. So you got to understand that if you have the presence of God inside your life, whatever you touch is turned to gold. But anyway, he goes to envy. He ends up in jail. Now, he stood there for 14 years. He stood there for 14 years. Now, I want you to understand this. A famine is coming. He stood there for 14 years because something was going to happen. First of all, he had issues with the household. So if God has a generational blessing, here goes the generational blessing. And so these guys have a thing with the other tribes. So what God does, he says, well, it says in Genesis 41:50, and this is moving forward. We can have the worship team come up. So we got Abraham, we have Isaac, we have Jacob, no Bible, no church. Just a story of my God. Then his story, that's his God. And then his story, that's his God. And then we get Joseph, the last of Jacob's, and that's his God. He goes to Egypt, and he goes to the top of the chain because of the favor of God. And so this is Genesis 41. It says, before the years of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph by Aseneth, daughter of Potipharah, priest of On. Joseph named his firstborn Manasseh, and said, it is because God has made me forget all my troubles and all my father's household. You know why he kept them there for 14 years? So that he can forgive his past. I'll tell you why. If he goes and be put in position when the famine come, and he would have seen his brothers and his family that betrayed him, he would have took him out. And because God already knew that in his heart, he says, before I let you go up there, I'm going to make you forget. Now listen to what he's saying. He said, God made me forget. In other words, he forgave everything that the household had done. Because when he gets in power, which he becomes in power, they came, and if it wasn't for Joseph, there will be no covenant. There will be no heirs to the covenant. So what God says, I'm going to make you forget the past. He said, sometimes we carry stuff that's holding us back, and sometimes God has to deal with us in those issues because he wants to take us somewhere, but we can't go to the top until we figure out what's going on in the bottom. God, there's always the promotion was there for Joseph. Joseph was going to be second in command. It was there. In 14 years, I think that it took 14 years because he didn't want to let go. And God had to do one thing. Watch this. Oh, this is so good. God had to show him his love. God had to show Joseph his love. So that Joseph could forgive the ones that did that in the past. Because if he wouldn't have forgave the people in the past, he would have destroyed them. Or he would have stuck in there. And then the Israelites and the famine would have all passed. But because God had a covenant with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, he used Joseph. He used Joseph in a place where he was down and out. Like he thought everything was gone. Let's talk about bad luck, right? He got sold by his brothers. He went through all this. Then he get accused for rape, and he didn't even have nothing to do with it. Now he's here for 14 years, and God is dealing with him. And sometimes there's things that we have in our hearts that we're dealing with, and God wants to take us to another place. And unless we see the Father's love, we will never understand what God wants to do in our life. And so the Father's love, we look at our kids, and we look at them with love. But God's love is even greater. And God is looking for someone to do something special. He's looking for someone, he'll say, that's the man. Because when God calls you, he calls you for something great. He calls you for something bigger than yourself. And that's why we honor today the Father. Because without the Father's love, look, for God so loved the world, he demonstrated his love through Christ. For God so loved the world. He so loved us, even in our place of midst of harboring unforgiveness, and even in the midst of our sin. For God so loved the world, he sent his son. Right? That's the demonstration of who God is. And I'm going to finish with this last verse in Galatians. See, we're talking about the promises of Abraham. We're like, oh, we're not Jews or we're not from that. But God did something when Jesus comes. Jesus comes into the picture and changes everything, because now we're also heirs. Look what it says here. It says, through Christ Jesus, God has blessed the Gentiles, that's us, with the same, everybody say the same, blessing he promised to who? Hold on. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of Joseph is my God now? Ooh. It's like a VIP. It's a VIP. Like we ain't even part of the Jewish generation, but because of a promise. Why? Because it was a promise to his seed. It wasn't seeds with an S. Even though the genealogy went down, but the seed that he's talking about was Jesus. And because we accept Jesus, we are two heirs with Abraham. Woo. So the minute I stand up for God, I'm in covenant with God. Then because I'm in covenant with God, even my generations to come are in covenant with God. Why? Because God is a God of covenant. And he remembers his covenant because of Jesus Christ. He says, so that we are what? Believers. So that we who are believers might receive the promise, the Holy Spirit through faith. The biggest gift you ever got was the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit brings you into the covenant. If you have the Holy Spirit in your life, if you accept the God into your life, then the Holy Spirit is your promise to the heirs of what Abraham said. Because God is a God of covenant, and God is a God of love. And through love, we understand that God has done something in our lives. So I want everybody to stand up as we celebrate the Father's love. Today I want to pray for all the fathers. Could all the fathers come up to the front? I want to pray for you guys. If all the fathers, yeah, just come up here. I want to pray for you guys, because I know what it is to be a man. I know what it is to have the commitment of doing something so great, right? To bring up a generation to know who God is, right? And I know how hard it is sometimes because as men, we figure things out internally and we blow up internally. You will never see it, except it's just a frustration that a man carries. And I think it's the responsibility that God gives us is a heavy responsibility, because we are to be leading a generation, to leading our kids into a journey with God. To even believe sometimes is hard, because we're seeing what's going on the outside, and then we're trying to believe with God. Like, it's frustrating. It's frustrating to be a man and then follow God, because like, hold on, I got to hear from God. Am I hearing from God? I'm not hearing from God. But the leading of the Holy Spirit is something, is a leading. Sometimes it's not a voice, it's a leading. And I know how much it is. So I want all the women, if you guys put your hands towards the men, because we need all your prayers you can give us. So let's pray. Father, we thank you that you're raising a generation of men who will follow you, who believe you. Lord, I ask for supernatural strength and ability in their lives, Lord, as they continue this journey that you have called them to be head of the house, the leaders of the house, Lord. Give them the wisdom. Give them the knowledge they need to fulfill what you've called them to do, Lord. They have a heavy calling in their lives, Lord. In this moment, we raise up the men, Lord. And let your anointing and your wisdom fall on them in a special way, Lord. Lord, right now we open the hearts so they can hear from you. Father, if there is any unbelief in their heart right now, we cast it out in the name of Jesus. If there's anything clogging their ears to hear from you clearly, right now we rebuke that in Jesus' name. Father, we ask you, Lord, that you continue moving in their lives in a special way, that you give them the strength and the ability to be the man of the house, to stand up and to say, as far as me and my household's concerned, we will serve the Lord, we will trust the Lord, we will believe in his promises. Father, I thank you for this moment that we get to honor the fathers. just as we're honoring you. And we know, Lord, that you're doing something special on earth, that you never stop working, that you're always up to something, that you're looking for a vessel that you can operate through. And here are men, Lord, here are men that are available. Father God, use them in a special way. In Jesus' name we pray, and the people of God say, amen, 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 amen.
Hey guys, thank you for joining us today. My name is George Caban. I'm the senior pastor here at Ignite. So happy that you tuned in. I hope that this message today edified you, built you up, and encouraged you, because that's what happens when we expose ourselves to the Word of God. And if you were so impacted that you want to accept Jesus into your life, I want to lead you in a small prayer. Could I? Great, let's go. Father, I believe you sent your Son to die for me. And on the third day, he resurrected. Today, I choose to open my heart to you, come into my life, and change everything according to your will. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Welcome to the family. We believe if you make this confession that you're part of a family. What's your next steps? I'll tell you. The first one is you have a prayer life. Spend some time with God. In your knees, laying down, in your inner voice, speak to God. You are his son and daughter, so you have that ability to commune with him. Number two, come visit us. Yes, come visit us. I would love to meet you in person. It's something different when you come into a community of believers. The synergy is awesome. And number three, if you do visit us, connect with us through Growth Track. That's when you get to hang out with me and the other pastors and find out the heart behind the church. Find out what it is that we're passionate about. And so we thank you, we love you, and hope to see you soon.